Okay, so we can continue what we have started. Do we have received the slides? Okay, perfect. So last time we have seen the starting principle or idea behind the interferometry, and we have seen also basic scheme like the Michelson in a bit of detail. Then just before a few words about Mach-Zehnder and Sagnac configuration. Now we have seen also that the instrument has a problem related to the fact that the interferometric signal is proportional to the cosine function of the phase difference between the measuring beam and the reference beam. And we have seen that one way to overcome this problem, this ambiguity problem, is to introduce the double beam interferometer. We have seen that this interferometer is a good one, because the resolution can go down to lambda divided by 8, so 8 nanometers more or less. And this is a cool resolution. And more or less this instrument is used to measure displacement of about 1 meter maximum. Okay? Takes into account that if the resolution is more or less, let's say 100 nanometers, to simplify calculation, the dynamic of 1 meter is a huge dynamic. Okay? And one of the main applications of this instrument is in mechanical position of object into an industry, right? So 1 meter of displacement is enough, much of the time. And we also see that all of the technique that we have seen last time are devoted to measure incremental movement, okay, of the moving target. Okay? Now today we will see again another possibility to overcome the ambiguity problem of the cosine function. And this other possibility is the double frequency interferometer. Then we will see also that we can use this instrument also to measure very little movement of a target, or better, vibration of a target around a quiescent point. Okay? This is a different approach, because incremental measurement of a displacement that are of course larger than the resolution, so larger for example than lambda over 8 for the double beam interferometer, are a set of instruments. Then there are other instruments that are called vibrometer that can measure very low a vibration, definitely lower than lambda over 8 in terms of length. And these are called vibrometer. We will see that this instrument can measure incremental displacement and also vibration of an object. Okay, now how does it work? It seems a bit more difficult, but the only difficulty is in the source. Because now we are using, again, an Achini laser, but today, right now, the laser is emitting on two modes, okay, not just one. And this particular wave function is related to the fact that we have used a magnetic field that is longitudinally applied to the laser cavity. Okay, if we do this, the laser gain there is split into two modes, and these two modes are separated by more or less 5 megahertz. This is what we can achieve. And they are orthogonally and circularly polarized. This is what we achieve. Now, this is the source. And there is also another particular object, because we have already seen the quarter wave plate that is used to change the state of polarization of emitted light. Last time, in the double beam interferometer, we have seen that the quarter wave plate change the polarization from linear to circular. In this case, we do the opposite, and we try to transform these two circular polarization into two linear ones. Okay? Okay? Then, a bisplitter, we have already seen this. Polarizer, we have already seen this. Photodiode, corner tube. And this is a particular object, okay? Because this is a Glenn tube, beam splitter. Now, what does it do? It separates polarization state. So, at the interface, inside this cube, we have particular material that do this. It reflects completely, for example, the polarization, linear polarization that is orthogonal to the slide, and it transmits completely the polarization state that is parallel to the slide. Okay, so here we do not separate power, but we separate polarization state. This is the strong idea. So this is a different object with respect to what we have seen. Now, how does it work, the quarter wave plate? As we have seen last time, for example, we can do this picture. This is the x-axis, the y-axis. And as you have seen in the slide, the fast axis or slow axis of the quarter wave plate is at 45 degrees with respect to y and x. So, for example, we have this situation. This is the fast axis, and this is the slow axis of the quarter wave plate. Okay? Now, let's concentrate, for example, on a polarization that is clockwise. Okay? Now, we can choose the principal axis of polarization as we want. Okay? Because the important thing is that we know that we have a circular polarization in this direction. Okay? So, let's suppose that we have a condition in which we enter. So, this is the input. The input interface of the quarter wave plate, and we have the maximum of the electric field in this direction. Okay? So now, if the polarization state is so that we have a clockwise rotation of the electric field, this means that if this component is at its maximum, the other one is at zero. Okay? And then, if let's say that we don't have the quarter wave plate, we continue to propagate, this component starts to go down and this component starts to go up. Okay? And so the electric field moves in this way. Okay? Perfect. But now we have the quarter wave plate. So, what happens? That the component that moves along this low axis sees an extra optical path. Okay, it is related to the fact that we have two refractive index. One is seen by this component, and the other one is seen by this component. So at the output of the quarter wave plate, we have this situation. Why? The situation is, as the component along the fast axis remain unchanged. So, we have the situation of before. But the component along the, sorry, the slow axis has seen a quarter wave of optical distance more than the one that propagates along the fast axis, so is in this position. Let's say it has reached its maximum. Okay? So now what we have, that the polarization state of light that is coming out from the quarter wave plate is linear, and in particular is polarized along the x-axis. So this is the E output. Okay? Now, in your opinion, what is happening to power, to optical power that is related to the electromagnetic wave? It is conserved or not? Well, of course, it is conserved. Because pay attention to the fact that when you have a circular polarization, the power is related to the square one is the square of this component plus the square of this component. Okay? So now, if the electric field is this one, the optical power is the same. Okay? This is a passive material. You cannot have gain. Okay? And because I have not said this last time, you don't have loss of power when you change the polarization state from linear to simple, of course, because the opposite is true. Okay. This is true only ideally, because you lose a minimum amount of power because of refracting index jump between air and the material, of course. So you have a bit of reflection. Okay. But this is quite normal. Okay, so of course, if now we have a polarization state that is circular but counterclockwise, okay, the opposite happens. And so if this is the condition at the entrance, then you have that at the output, you have this. If this is the polarization state, this means that when this goes down, this goes up. Okay? So the electric field moves in this direction. Then at the output of the quantum wave plate, you have this condition. And so now the resulting electric field is polarized along the y-axis. Okay? So this is why it is truly important that you satisfy this condition. The fast or slow axis, this is not important, must be at 45 degrees with respect, for example, to the plane of the slide. In order to have a polarization state that is polarized, a linear polarization in the y-axis or parallel to the slide, and a polarization state that is linear and parallel to the slide or along the x-axis. Okay? Okay, very good. Now, before, this is another important difference between this solution and the double wing solution. Before going outside of the instrument, you take a very little part of the beam, of the two beam, say 4-5% of both, and then you build, let's say, a reference signal. Okay? So we don't it's a bit different with respect to what we have done until now. And again, since these two linear polarizations are orthogonal, to have interference between the two, you have to use a polarizer that is a 45 degree, because you have to take a bit of component from this one and the same bit of component from this one. The easiest way is to use a polarizer that is 45 degree. Okay? You lost half of the power of this component, you lost half of the power of this component, but you have interference between the two modes. Okay? And so what you will have here? You have a signal that is modulated by the frequency difference of the two modes. Okay? Perfect. Now you enter the real interferometer. Okay? And so you have something that is closer to what we already seen. So, for example, the polarization of mode 1 is used as a reference polarization, or to build up a reference signal. And the polarization of mode 2 is sent to the measuring corner Q. Okay? And again, here at this interface, the two polarizations are recombined. And again, to have interference of the two, we have to use another polarizer at 45 degrees. Okay? So the really important thing is that now the displacement of the moving target appears as a phase modulation of the measuring signal. This is the really important point and difference. Okay. So this is what happened. We have a part of the module, let's say, of the signal that is not distorted. We have this condition. We have a signal that has a fixed frequency that is related to the frequency difference between the two modes. And this is the reference signal. And then you have the measuring signal that, again, has the same frequency difference. Okay? Now you have, again, the usual, let's call, phase difference between the measuring beam and the reference beam, because this is still true, of course. You have a phase, it is related to the starting phase of the two modes. Okay? So you can rewrite this as a constant frequency, a possible varying phase, because Ln can change, because the moving target can move, as before, and then a fixed phase, that is not important in the reasoning, because this point is always the same, because if you are able to, let's say, mount directly the reference corner cube on top of the Glahn cube spin splitter, this distance remains fixed. Okay? And now, in your opinion, why this is a very good condition with respect to the other solution? Because now the information on displacement is overposed over a carrier. This is the really important point. Now, you are not making any more a baseband measurement. But the measurement is overposed on a carrier that is a F1 minus F2 frequency. This is, we see that this can lead to a better analysis, let's say, of the displacement of the target. Okay? I have changed a bit something in the slide that I sent to you. For example, probably I have used S instead of L. It was not so clear, but anyway, this is the correct convention, let's say. Now, the point is, okay, how we can retrieve the information on Ln, on the variation of the measuring path. Okay, we can use the usual approach, so we can try to go back to the double beam interferometer because we know that it works, but instead it's better definitely to use a digital approach, in which, in particular, it is really, really easy. The concept is that we measure the periods of this signal and of this signal for a particular time interval. This time interval is the refraction time of the measurement. We are counting the period, nothing more. And this is related to the fact that we are not anymore performing a baseband measure, but now the measurement is, or well, better. The information is overposed to a carrier. This is the only secret of this instrument. So, you can do something like this. You use comparator and digital counter. What does they do? They do an operation of integration, more or less. And so this is the result. If you look at the frequency of the two signals, you have something like this. Remember that the idea is to count the period. So the phase of the reference beam is given by 2 pi. Sorry. Okay, it's this one. So it is 2 pi F1 minus F2 multiplied by 2. Okay? That's good to zero the starting phase of the beam. It's not important. Okay? And then what you have, that the phase of the measuring beam is again 2 pi F1 minus F2 multiplied by T plus 2k Lm plus R, a constant, okay? Now, if you look at the phase, and you recall that the phase is defined in this way, with the derivative of the phase divided by the phi, so if you recall that frequency is in general given by the phi over the t, what you get? You get that the frequency, let's say, of the reference signal is just given by f1 minus f2. Okay. And that the frequency, I go here, and that the frequency of the measuring signal is given by, again, f1 minus f2 plus, this is important, 2k dl m divided by t. Of course, this term is constant, so we can eliminate it. Okay? So these two are the frequency. Now, if we integrate these frequencies, and this is the operation that is done by the counter, by the digital counter, in a refraction period that is t, let's say 1/10 of a second, 2/10 of a second, you can decide this time, okay? You count the period in the time t, capital T. And so, in particular, you will have a fixed amount of period for the reference counter that is simply given by the frequency integrated in time, okay? So we have this number. Then if you do the same calculation for the measuring signal, you have, again, a fixed number of period that are modulated by the movement of the displacing target, okay? In particular, what happens for you if the target moves away from the instrument? What happens to the frequency? You can look at that, at the frequency of the measuring signal. If I'm moving far away from the instrument, the sign of this derivative is positive or negative? It's positive. So the number of period that I measure in the same time, t, is increased with respect to this, to the number of period that I measure with the reference signal. Okay? This is good. Now, there is another point. If now I go back towards the instrument, this derivative is negative. Okay? And so what does it mean? That the frequency of the measuring signal is going lower than the frequency of the reference signal. Okay? Okay. So if you add these two, well, if you look at what the two counter get, you can do a subtraction operation. So this operation, you subtract the value of the measuring counter. Sorry, you subtract the value of the reference counter to the value of the measuring counter. Okay, and what you get is this. Okay, what you get is, that Cm minus Cr is given by VL, okay? VLm 2/1, okay? And this is equal to an integer number of counts, okay? So now, how you can get the distance that is the distance by which the moving target is moved, that is dlm, this is the distance integrated in the measuring time t, okay? DRM is then given by an integer number of count that is multiplied by lambda over 2. Okay? So, counting the period of the measuring and reference signal, we have built an instrument that is able to measure the incremental movement of the moving target with a resolution that is lambda over 2. Okay? Very easy, very easy. Now, in your opinion, it's easy or not to start to try to double the resolution? To try to work with a resolution lambda over 4. This is something that we have seen, of course, last Wednesday. And it is in particular related to the fact that I say, okay, we are counting the period of the two signals. But if you are able to count also the semi period of the two signals, we can double the resolution. This is more or less the same thing. Okay? So, the maximum resolution of this instrument is related to lambda over 4. Okay? The simple way to present to you this instrument is to present the counting of period, but we can go further and we can have a better resolution, a double one. Okay? And now, with respect to the double beam interferometer, if you remember, with the double beam interferometer, we were not able to detect the target at rest. Okay? Because if you remember, the analysis of the double beam interferometer says that we must do the derivative of the cosine and sine signal. Okay, so if you must do a derivative, you have a high pass filter, and so you cannot measure DC movement. Or DC in this way means that the target is at rest. But now instead, with this condition, in which you perform the measurement in this way, you have always this subtraction. Okay, I can seal out the frequency. But if the target is at rest, frequency of the reference signal remains, of course, f1 minus f2. The frequency of the measuring signal came, that is, sorry, F1 minus F2 plus 2k dLm minus over the field, sorry. If the target is at rest, so you don't have this value, the two counter has the same number of counts. And so dL is exactly equal to 0. You are able to understand if your target has moved and then it has stopped. You can understand this. So you don't have limitation in the low frequency content, let's say, of movement of the target. In your opinion, why? Because again, or well, better, no, it's different. So you don't have the limitation on the low frequency content of the signal. Okay? This is very good. Now, in your opinion, last time I said that the value of the comparator, in particular the choice of this value, by which you construct the square signal, is very critical. It's not easy. It's not trivial to understand what is this value. Of course, also for the double frequency interferometer, you have a signal, two signals, sorry, that has a DC content. Okay? But now, if you can seal out the DC content of these two signals, what happens for you? You lose information or not? You don't lose information. So you can do two things. The comparator used can be set to use zero. as the comparator comparison value. Okay? This is another important point. Because now if you to avoid or to cancel out the DC content, you have to use a high pass filter. Okay? So it's even confusing. But now the information is not in baseband, it is overposed to a carrier. This is the right point. Okay? So if you do the high pass, if you use a high pass filter to cancel out the DC content, to use a comparator that uses zero or ground as the reference, the information on the movement is still on a signal that is at 5 MHz. Okay? And this is the reason for which you are able to detect the target at rest. So this is the reason for which you don't have limitation in the low frequency content of movement. Okay? Good. Now, we have, anyway, however, a limitation in the high velocity or high frequency content of the signal. Why, in your opinion? Because again, we are counting, well, the displacement is given in counts that are related to the resolution, is lambda over 2 or lambda over 4. Okay? So we have something that was similar to the double beam interferometer in particular, the resolution, or well, better, the maximum velocity of the target is always given by of the target given by the resolution, or let's say let's use lambda over 2 as it is in the slide, multiplied by the electronic bandwidth, the bandwidth of the electronic components. Okay? Now the point is, could you use, for example, a bandwidth of 10 MHz? Last time we have done the example. I don't know if it is written in the slide. No, it is not written in the slide. Okay. But anyway, last time we have used an electronic bandwidth of 10 MHz. In your opinion, could you use the same electronic bandwidth here to understand what is the maximum velocity or not? Recall that now we are analyzing a signal that is overposed to a carrier. So we have a carrier modulation, or a frequency modulation of this carrier. Okay? So if you look at spectrum.